Good morning all. Today we can have a discussion on accounting concepts and conventions. As you all know, accounting concepts and conventions are the basic accounting foundations on the basis of which the discipline of accounting is based. Unfortunately, our students, even after they have passing BCom class 2 or post graduation, are not actually aware of accounting concepts and conventions. Actually, what all activities or what all procedures we are doing in accounting discipline, that is actually based on this accounting concepts and conventions. So in this session, we can have a detailed discussion on accounting concepts and conventions. In total, we have 10 accounting concepts and 4 accounting conventions. So let's move on to this. So among 10 accounting concepts, the first concept we have, that is cost concept. Cost concept is actually an accounting concept whereby the assets should be recorded at its cost and adequate depreciation should be provided for the life of the asset. It is also known as, this cost concept is also known as historical cost concept. Actually, cost here means the purchase cost and not the market price. Here we are dealing with two terms, two main important terms, appreciation and depreciation of asset. Appreciation means it's an increase in the value of asset. Appreciation is actually treated as a gain and the difference in value should be recorded as revaluation surplus. And depreciation is decrease in the value of asset and should be deducted from the cost to find out the written down value in the balance sheet. And for example for this cost concept is actually assets are recorded at the purchase price or the cost price and adequate depreciation is deducted so as to get the return on value in the balance sheet. So this procedure is actually done as per the cost concept. And we have the second concept, that is business entity concept. Actually, business entity concept states that the business is separate from its owner or the proprietor. Therefore, the accounting records must be kept separate from that of the personal affairs of the owner. The accounting records of the organization should exclude the personal assets and liabilities of the owner. It is also known as separate entity concept or economic entity concept. Example for this concept is in the balance sheet of the business, capital is shown as a liability after deducting the drawings because it is to be repaid by the business to the owner. So this procedure is actually done in the balance sheet as per the business entity concept. And we have this third concept, that is going concern concept. Actually, financial statements are prepared on the assumption that the enterprise is a going concern and will continue in operation for an indefinite period of time. No enterprise is actually started with an intention to stop at the middle of the time, rather it will be continued till the date of its winding up. Example for this concept is assets are valued at its historical cost or purchase cost, less depreciation and not at the realizable value since the assets are not intended for sale but intended to be used for an indefinite period of time. So this is actually done as per the going concern concept. And fourth concept is money measurement concept. As per the money measurement concept, only those transactions which can be measured in terms of money are recorded in the financial statements. The transactions, even if they affect the business materially, are not recorded in the books of accounts if they are not convertible in monetary terms. Example for this concept is employees of an organization, though the assets of the company cannot be recorded in the books of accounts since it cannot be expressed in terms of money. So this is actually employees cannot be counted in terms of money. So that's why we cannot record this asset of employees in the books of accounts as per the money measurement concept. And fifth concept is that is the accounting period concept. This is also known as definite accounting period concept. As per the going concern concept, as we have seen, the entity will have an indefinite period of life. It is not desirable to measure its performance as well as the financial position at the end of its life period. So, a small but workable fraction of the time is chosen out of the infinite life cycle of the business entity for measuring the financial position. According to this concept, accounts should be prepared after every period and not at the end of the life of the entity. Usually, this period is called as one calendar year. In India, we follow from 1st April to 31st March every year as our financial year. So this financial year from April to March is followed as per accounting period concept. And the sixth concept is dual aspect concept. This concept is the core of double entry bookkeeping. As per this concept, every transaction or every event has two aspects, that is debit and credit. This gives the basic accounting equation. You might have heard about the basic accounting equation, that is equity plus liabilities is equal to assets. This concept is leading to the tallying of balance sheet. Why we are tallying the balance sheet? Why we are telling the students to tally the balance sheet is only because of the reason that there is an accounting equation, that is equity plus liabilities is equal to assets. We have the asset side and the liability side. Asset side should be tallied with the liability side. So liability side indicates equity plus liabilities, and asset side indicates all the fixed assets and current assets. So these two sides should be tallied as per the dual aspect concept. And the next concept is matching concept. As per this concept, all the expenses matched with the revenue of that period should be taken into consideration. If any revenue is recognized, then expenses related to that revenue should also be recorded. The purpose of matching concept is to avoid the misstatement of earnings for the period. Reporting revenues for a period without stating all the liabilities related to that income will result in overstated profit. Example for this concept is that the cost of the asset purchased should be apportioned as depreciation for every year so as to match with the cost of the asset. The next concept we have, that is a realization concept. As per this concept, the revenue or income should be recorded when it is earned, irrespective of whether the cash from the transaction has been received or not. This realization concept is also known as revenue recognition principle. In the case of sale of goods, revenue must be recognized when the seller transfers the risk or rewards associated with the ownership of the goods to the buyer. That is, when the seller transfers the risk and rewards to the buyer, whether cash from this sale received or not. Example for this realization concept is prepaid expense, accrued income. Then the next concept is that accrual concept. Accrual concept means the recognition of revenue and cost as and when they are earned or incurred and not when it is received or paid. So every income or every expense should be recorded at the time when it is earned, when it is due, and not when it is received or paid. As per this concept, the transactions or events are recognized on accrual basis, on due basis, that is when they occur and not when they are received or paid. Transactions should be recorded in the financial statements of the period to which they relate. Financial statements prepared on accrual basis so as to inform the users not only the payment and receipt of cash, but also of the obligation to pay cash in future. Example for this accrual concept or for this due concept is that outstanding expenses are to be debited and outstanding incomes are to be credited in profit and loss account as per the accrual concept. And the next concept, the last concept we have, verifiable objective concept. As per this concept, all the transactions recorded in the books of accounts should be supported by adequate supporting evidence. The documentary evidence should be free from any bias. You might have heard about bills, vouchers, invoices, etc. These are called documentary evidences. That means the accounting should be free from personal bias. We cannot record a particular transaction if you are not having a bill or something that is documentary evidence with you. The supporting documents provide the basis for accounting and auditing. Example for this documentary evidence is cash memo, invoice, sale bill, etc. And next we have the accounting conventions. So we have in total 10 accounting concepts, and here accounting conventions. Actually, what is accounting conventions? These are the accounting principles on the basis of which the financial statements are to be maintained. Underline the term maintained. These are accounting principles adopted by various organizations over a period of time. accounting conventions need not have the universal applications, the worldwide applications. Concepts are used to record or prepare the transactions in the financial statements, whereas conventions are needed to maintain the books of accounts. Concepts have universal application, whereas the conventions may not have the universal application. And the first convention is convention of full disclosure. We have to fully disclose the transactions. The financial statements must disclose all the reliable and relevant information about the business enterprise to the management and also to their external users. It will help them to take reasonable and rational decisions about their investment. The disclosure should be full and final so that the users can correctly assess the financial position of the enterprise. This principle implies that nothing should be omitted to record. Example for this convention of full disclosure is that the disclosure of transaction in the balance sheet and profit and loss account fully. And the next convention we have, convention of consistency. As per this concept, the accounting principles we are following in the business from period to period should be consistent from time to time in order to achieve the comparability of the financial statements. A change in the accounting policy is made only in certain exceptional circumstances. The convention of consistency is applied when alternative methods of accounting are equally acceptable. Example for this, you might have heard about various methods of depreciation, various methods of inventory valuation. So we can use any type of depreciation method, any type of inventory valuation, but we cannot change this inventory method of valuation from time to time. We cannot change the method of depreciation from time to time. If you have to change, or if you are in need of a change, it should be in exceptional circumstances. So this is actually based on convention of consistency. Your principles should be consistent from time to time. And the next convention is convention of materiality. As per this convention, all the items having a significant effect on the business of the firm should be disclosed in the financial statements, and any insignificant item, any immaterial item should not be disclosed in the financial statements. So materiality means material item, that means important item, that means significant item. The term materiality is actually a relative term, that is depending on the volume of transaction of each situation. Example, a default by a customer who owes only 1,000 rupees to a company having a net asset worth of rupees 10 crore is immaterial to the financial statements of the company. Understood? However, if the amount of default was 2 crores, what about the situation? The information would be actually material to the financial statements. So it is based on the volume of transaction, the materiality determines. So we have to record the transactions as per the convention of materiality. And convention of conservatism, the last convention. This convention states that the accountant should not anticipate income and should provide for all the possible losses. As per this concept, or as per this convention, the accountant should choose the method of valuation which leads to the lesser value. That means we cannot anticipate profit, but we can anticipate loss. As per this convention, there are three qualitative characteristics of financial statements. That is prudence, provide for all possible losses. Neutrality, exclude all uncertain gains. That means if you are not able to imagine a particular type of transaction, the effect of particular type of transaction, you cannot record that. And the third one, faithful, that is representation of alternative values. Example for this convention of conservatism is the golden rule of current asset valuation is cost or market price, whichever is lower. We know that the current asset should be valued at cost or market price, whichever is lower. This is actually based on the convention of conservatism. So we have to take the lesser value. Okay, so that is the last convention. So to conclude, it is very clear from the above that we have 10 accounting concepts and 4 accounting conventions. Actually, accounting concept is used for recording the transactions in the financial statements, but accounting conventions are actually used for maintaining the financial statements from period to period. So this is what about accounting conventions and accounting concepts. These are the two pillars of accounting principles. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.